Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents A Foot Soldier for Patton, the story of a Red Diamond infantryman with the U.S. Third Army, by Michael C. Bilder with James Bilder, narrated by Johnny Heller. Foreword. As an infantryman in the 2nd Regiment of the 5th Infantry Division, Michael Bilder crossed the Zahara River on January 18, 1945, and participated in the liberation of my hometown of Diekirch and the Grand Duchy of Luxembourg. It is thus indeed an honor and a pleasure for me, as curator of the National Museum of Military History in Diekirch, to write a foreword for his fascinating memoir, A Foot Soldier for Patton. Spanning the entirety of his service from 1941 to 1945, this book is more than a personal memoir of World War II. It is a tribute to the countless frontline soldiers who experienced similar events but, for whatever reasons, have remained silent. More than 60 years ago, hundreds of thousands of American GIs from all walks of life came to Europe to fight in a terrible war. Some were highly educated, others were factory workers and farmers, but all understood that they were being sent to help oppressed nations regain their freedom, liberty, and democratic values. They knew they were risking their lives for this just and noble cause, and thousands gave their last full measure of devotion to reestablish those values, a most precious gift to mankind. Few veterans, however, have such a record as Michael Bilder. He was, to begin with, a member of one of the first American contingents to go overseas. Arriving in Iceland in early 1942, he served 18 months in an Arctic landscape as the United States geared up for the Great Crusade in Western Europe. Shipped to France in July 1944, he then participated in 5 campaigns. As part of General Patton's Third Army, he and his buddies in the Red Diamond Division fought their way all across Western Europe, from the breakout in Normandy to the meat grinder of Metz to the bitter Ardennes, and on to the final battles in Germany and Czechoslovakia. PFC Bilder was there, thanks to military skills acquired in a long and arduous training, or perhaps to the care of a personal guardian angel. He survived without serious wounds. He went on to serve in the occupation of a defeated Germany before returning to the United States in August 1945. The liberation of Diekirch was part of one of the bloodiest and cruelest battles of World War II, today known simply as the Battle of the Bulge. I was not yet born when PFC Bilder and his fellow soldiers fought to free my town, enduring sub-zero temperatures, knee-deep snow, frozen feet, little sleep, cold food, enemy fire, and the anguish of witnessing friends wounded and killed, all in the terrifying atmosphere of continuous battle. After weeks of unparalleled hardship, the United States Army succeeded in driving back a determined and aggressive enemy. They pierced the Siegfried Line in early February 1945, beginning the invasion of mainland Nazi Germany that ended 4 months later in total enemy defeat. All of America's sons and daughters from the greatest generation who participated in Europe, the Pacific, or other theaters, and managed to survive the war, were marked by the suffering, death, and destruction they witnessed. Frontline infantry soldiers like PFC Bilder encountered these horrors on a daily basis. Once back home, they tried to adjust to normal life, raise a family, and concentrate on their jobs. All tried to quickly forget the horrors of war, but countless veterans were traumatized, and many are still haunted by nightmares. Some shared their experiences with family members. Most were never able to open up, but all remained proud in the knowledge that they had done their duty and personally contributed to the full victory over the evil of Nazism or other fascist regimes. Decades after the war, Michael Bilder, now in his retirement, began to reflect in detail on his war experiences. He was spurred on by his son James, who developed a great interest in recording his father's story. Motivated by the desire to preserve his father's wealth of information and a strong love of family history, James Bilder effectively co-authored A Foot Soldier for Patton, creating a striking and lively written account based on his father's oral history of the war years. The memoir truly captures not only the experience of his father and countless other American GIs, but also that of an entire nation. It is a story we especially need to hear now, as America's greatest generation is regrettably passing away. The world has fewer and fewer witnesses to the horrors of World War II combat, and memoirs such as the Bilder's are both a valuable source of first-hand information and a key to preserving the collective memory of World War II for future generations. The attention to detail and the personal feelings of a frontline soldier, here captured in an open, frank, and unveiled way, makes for a fascinating listening. These qualities also make a foot soldier for Patton highly recommended for the classroom, or for any group interested in history as told by first-person witnesses. As a fellow student of World War II with a key interest in oral history, I commend James Bilder for this superb account. His father's actions are representative of what thousands of American GIs experienced on the battlefields of World War II. For many American GIs, the Luxembourg American Cemetery has become the final resting place. Their numbers include some of Michael Bilder's closest friends. I express my eternal gratitude to him and all the other American soldiers who sacrificed so much to liberate my hometown and country during the Battle of the Bulge. Lest we forget, Roland J. Gall, Curator, National Museum of Military History, Diekirch, Luxembourg, nat-military-museum.lu. Headquarters, 15th U.S. Army, Office of the Commanding General, APO 408, 17 November 1945. To the officers and men of the 5th Infantry Division, nothing I can say can add to the glory which you've achieved. Throughout the whole advance across France, you spearheaded the attack of your corps. You crossed so many rivers that I am persuaded many of you have webbed feet, and I know that all of you have dauntless spirit. To my mind, history does not record incidents of greater valor than your assault crossings of the Saar and the Rhine. Concerning the former operation, I showed the scene of your glorious exploit to a civilian, for whom I have the highest esteem. After looking at it for some time, he said, "I did not believe there was enough courage in the world to achieve such a victory." Knowing the 5th Infantry Division, I was sure you would achieve it, and you did. Now that peace has been reestablished, I am sure all of you will continue through the remainder of your lives to stand for those great qualities of America, which in war you so magnificently demonstrated. With affectionate regards and sincere congratulations, I am, as ever, your devoted commander, George S. Patton, Jr., General. Introduction. My father seldom volunteered, but never hesitated when asked to talk about his various military and combat experiences from the war, and we pleaded with him to do this often as we were growing up. He always had one story or another that would widen our eyes, entertain, or just plain provide us with a good lesson for life. We made him tell them over and over again until, after years of repetition, we had committed many of the incidents to memory. We kids and our buddies were not the only ones who made it a practice to ask him about his experiences. Friends, relatives, and even strangers wanted to talk with a real GI from Patton's Third Army who had witnessed America's involvement in World War II and survived the fighting from start to finish, from Normandy all the way to VE Day in Czechoslovakia. I was then, and remain today, awed by his experiences. None of this is to say that my father was a braggart or even considered himself a hero. In fact, it was quite the opposite. Despite being decorated for valor in combat by no less than 3 different nations, he always said that when the order to retreat was given, he led the way in running away from the enemy. The only times he discussed his experiences without any prompting from others was in the company of fellow combat vets. He always regarded his actions as typical of everyone who served at the time, and as nothing especially noteworthy. My father was never lacking when it came to a sense of humor, and enjoyed most recounting his countless shenanigans, some of which could have landed him in Leavenworth prison. He kept his characteristic in civilian life, and even had me believing when I was in kindergarten that he had been killed twice during the war. Born in Chicago to parents who immigrated from Germany, he was drafted into the Army 8 months before the attack on Pearl Harbor, participated in the famed Southern Maneuvers of 1941, served 18 months of occupation duty in Iceland, had training in commando tactics, and as a combat lifeguard in England, got additional training in Northern Ireland and shipped out for France in early July 1944. As a foot soldier for Patton, he participated in the fierce fighting of all five of the Third Army's bloody campaigns. His experiences in the war were often unusual for an American soldier, since he could speak fluent German with a good German accent. This made for many interesting encounters with enemy soldiers, as well as frequent calls to serve as an interpreter for American officers interrogating German POWs. Certified as a lifeguard by the American Red Cross in October 1943, he was among those who had to jump into French and German rivers when the small assault boats used by American infantrymen overturned under enemy fire and spilled their men into the water. My father would swim to the river bottom, unhook their heavy packs, and push them up to the surface. He would then return to the surface himself, to be pulled back into an assault boat by his fellow soldiers and resume his duties as a rifleman. Finally, when he was in England, my father was recruited to perform an additional duty once the 5th Division got into combat. Since the administrative personnel of the American Red Cross were not combat soldiers, or even part of the U.S. military, they were not allowed to be directly on the front lines. It became my father's responsibility to travel by jeep from one company to another to deliver Red Cross messages from home, usually bad news, to soldiers at the front all throughout the 2nd Regiment. He would then spend a few days temporarily attached to whatever company received his messages. Like something out of Hollywood, my father's story even concluded with a happy ending. He survived the war, was decorated, came home unscathed, married my mother, and went on to fulfill his ambitions to live the American dream. It doesn't get any more fascinating than that for those of us who can't get enough of World War II and the generation who fought it. My father said he could speak freely about his experiences because his actions in combat gave him nothing to be ashamed of. I would listen to these as well as his non-combat tales of military life as I was growing up, and even then think to myself, somebody really ought to write a book about this. As I was nearing my mid-40s, having an undergraduate degree in journalism and a love of all things historical, especially military and family history, I decided I should get it done while he was still around. My father and I began with a tape recorder in 1988. At the time, he did not want to spend so much time reliving memories of friends and youth lost. He even feared the Army would come back decades later to take away his good conduct medal. Despite these concerns, we accumulated numerous hours of tape, countless letters, and official histories, and read and reviewed numerous books and articles. Unfortunately, the normal obligations of life sapped most of my attention and energies during the 1990s. It seemed like too big a project to accomplish. It was only after my father turned 85 and my mother died in 2004 that I realized it was now or never and threw things into high gear, devoting virtually all my free time to finishing this project. I truly owe my beautiful wife big time for putting up with this. This book gives the listener a thorough understanding of how soldiers of the time were trained, fed, clothed, equipped, and treated. It provides in detail the horrors of combat and the misery of life on the front lines. It reveals what most GIs were feeling and how at least one of them thought. It is also in layman's terms, so that the listener need not have served in the military to understand it. I hope this brings some long-overdue justice to the 5th Infantry Division. Soldiers with the Red Diamond participated in long and bloody campaigns, but get very little mention in contemporary histories about World War II. The desire to help rectify the historical record and give credit to the men of the forgotten 5th were part of the reason I was determined to write this book. I hope my father's memoirs shed additional light on this fascinating and important part of Patton's victories in Northern Europe. I apologize if an incident is off by a week or in fact occurred in another small town nearby, but errors such as these should be relatively rare. It has been thoroughly researched, and my father's memory was very solid when we worked seriously on the tapes and notes in the 1980s. Still, it is important to remember that this is a memoir and not a work of academic research. Dates and statistics are from the official histories of the U.S. Army, 2nd Regiment, and 5th Infantry Division. If my father is alive when this memoir is published, I would ask that he be spared any phone calls or visits. He is now 89, and feels he has spent enough time reliving bad memories. Also, his ability for names and even incidents has started to slip, so I'm glad we're able to bring this work to a timely finish. This book, this memoir, is a true labor of love. My father consented to tell his story out of love for me, and in turn, I wrote it for love of him, as well as for my passion for all things historical, and especially for family and military history. In this case, both overlapped. I sincerely hope that listeners enjoy this footnote to history and have as much fun hearing it as I did writing it. I hope it does justice to the American soldiers of World War II in general, and in particular, to the men of the 5th Infantry Division. James G. Bilder, 2008. Chapter 1. Peacetime Induction. Just a one-year hitch for preparedness. I'm nobody. Who are you? Are you nobody, too? Emily Dickinson. I'm nobody. Who are you? I didn't know it at the time, but September 16, 1940 was a date that would have a pivotal impact on my life. On that day, Franklin Roosevelt signed the Selective Service Act into law. It was the start of the first peacetime draft in American history. Induction in the United States had previously taken place only as a necessity of war. It first occurred in 1863 at the midpoint of the Civil War, and again in 1917, after the United States entered World War I. Selective service was thus synonymous with war to most Americans, and it created a considerable amount of apprehension. Circumstances in 1940 caused a strange, almost schizophrenic split in our thinking. Much of the globe was embroiled in another world war. Most Americans, on the other hand, were isolationists at heart and wanted no part in it. Any American who had graduated from grade school was familiar with George Washington's farewell address, in which he warned his countrymen against entangling foreign alliances. Washington's advice seemed horrifically justified after the United States entered World War I and won what appeared to be a meaningless victory in a never-ending line of European struggles and conquests. As in 1917, interventionists in 1940 wanted to send every aid short of war to assist the Allied nations in their struggle. This included the United States President, Franklin Delano Roosevelt, who insisted that the Allies were fighting our fight, implying that if American aid failed to win the war for the Allies, then America herself should enter the conflict. We wondered, were the interventionists right this time? This split thinking also spilled into America's foreign policy. Neutrality laws that had been on the books since the mid-1930s were amended so that policies such as cash and carry and lend-lease enabled the states to extend armaments to nations that were friendly to democratic values. America could remain officially neutral while still taking sides. The result of war-related manufacturing made America the world's arsenal of democracy and produced yet another strange split in our values and thoughts, as the very war most Americans wanted to avoid was producing jobs and a potential end to the terrible depression of the 1930s. Even the presidential election campaign that year split America over an issue that it had never before experienced. An American president was running for a third term of office. The entire campaign centered on foreign policy. Who, Roosevelt, the incumbent president, or Wilkie, the business and administrative whiz kid, could best get the country prepared for war without getting us into the fray? This was the two-sided coin of our circumstances in the early war years. We all saw the ominous events occurring throughout the world in 1940. By September, the war had been underway for a year, and the Nazis and Soviets had already overrun most of Europe, while the Japanese did much the same in Asia. This was disconcerting, but it occurred across the oceans, on continents far from our own. The attack on Pearl Harbor was more than 15 months away. Meanwhile, we enjoyed America's neutrality. My generation was young and largely oblivious to many of the details related to all these happenings. We were busy getting on with our lives. Things were far from perfect, but I had good things to enjoy in the big city of Chicago where I lived. On a hot summer's night, we went to plush movie houses like the Avalon Theater to sit in the comfort of air conditioning and watch Hollywood's best on a huge silver screen. We went horseback riding in Washington Park, rented rowboats in Jackson Park, and went to see the Cubs play at Wrigley Field or watch the White Sox at Comiskey Park. The most popular activity of all was dancing. "You don't mean a thing if it ain't got that swing," went the song. Everybody danced. We all loved it, and it was a great way for guys and gals to mix. Chicago was a hub for great music and big bands, and we saw and heard them all. Glenn Miller, Tommy Dorsey, Benny Goodman, Les Brown and his band of renown, and countless others. A peacetime draft for America was a historic first, but hardly the type of thing to lead to serious protests. There was a real debate as to whether the country should get involved in the war, but there was never any question as to whether we should be able to defend it. Under the new conscription law, the government required all males between the ages of 21 and 35, residents and aliens alike, to register for the draft. This process allowed 900,000 selectees to be inducted into the Army to serve a 12-month hitch. We knew that this would help make the country better prepared militarily and more likely to deter any attack from a foreign dictator. The draft certainly seemed reasonable under the circumstances. Nazi Germany and Soviet Russia were still allies in 1940. Hitler also had alliances with Italy and Japan, and the only belligerents of any significance were the British and Chinese. It only made sense that American military might be strong enough to give aggressors reason to think before attacking us. I met the legal criteria for draft eligibility, so I walked the two blocks over to Hendricks Public Grammar School at the corner of 43rd and Princeton and registered on October 16, 1940. I had attended Hendricks for kindergarten and first grade, but completed the rest of my grammar school education at St. George Catholic Grade School. The registrar's report listed me as 6 feet, 1 inch, 195 pounds, with brown hair and eyes and a ruddy complexion. I was order number 765, and my registration serial number was 2,639. I was now a number among the 16 million men who registered for the draft. I had been employed for 2 years as a shipping clerk at the Sears and Roebuck warehouse at 1400 West 35th Street in Chicago. My main qualification for the job had been my Catholic faith. In the days when people and companies were free to practice discrimination of all types, we were asked to list our religion on our employment applications. A clerk at Sears explained to me later that they liked to hire Catholics because, in their words, they felt the Catholics were less likely to steal. A few years earlier, before the draft, and even before the war itself, some of the guys in the neighborhood were far-sighted enough to see another world war as inevitable and join the National Guard with the hope of having some rank and a good assignment by the time the war came. They tried to talk me into doing the same, promising me I'd get a good deal. But I wanted no part of it. I was happy to enjoy civilian life in its creature comforts, and it literally took an act of Congress to get me to give them up. Despite my love of the creature comforts, I had gone to the Canadians in 1939 to inquire about enlisting in the RAF. I had loved flight ever since I first read about the brave knights of the air who did battle amongst the clouds in World War I. I saw movies like Hell's Angels, Dawn Patrol, and The Eagle and the Hawk over and over again, and dreamed of one day flying in combat. I had two problems. First, I had no college, and fighter pilots were expected to have at least 2 years of undergraduate work upon induction. Second, and more importantly, I had problems with depth perception. These became obvious when I took private flying lessons at Lewis College near Joliet. Whenever I lined up my approach to land, I always angled my plane with the wing on my right dipping down. It seemed level to me, but the instructor always had to take the controls. Needless to say, the Canadians rejected me. I felt no real apprehension or resentment at being drafted into the Army. After all, the war was in Europe and the Pacific, and the United States wasn't involved. Roosevelt won his third term as president in large part by pledging at the Boston Gardens a few days before the election, "I've said this before, but I shall say it again and again. Your boys are not going to be sent into any foreign wars." My family and I accepted that presidential campaign promise at face value. The feeling amongst most Americans, as many as 80% according to the polls of the day, was that while America should be prepared and the defeat of the Axis powers was important, foreign wars didn't really concern us, and we should make every effort to stay out of them. We had oceans to separate and protect us from aggressors. We regarded ourselves as wiser in 1940 than we had been in 1917. America would not be tricked into war again. We would walk softly and carry a big stick, making every attempt to stay out of conflict. Still, there was a nagging suspicion, even a fear, that things were getting out of hand overseas. We all knew that something would have to be done, but hoped that England and China would be the ones to do it. Even in 1940 and 1941, however, it was obvious that they were hanging on by their fingernails. Maybe if we could show foreign dictators that we were no one to tread on, that would be enough. At least, that was what many of us hoped. Like almost every other young man at the time, I didn't mind going into the army for a year. It was only the fighting that concerned me. My selective service records show that on March 13, 1941, the government mailed me an 8-page questionnaire, which I completed and returned within 6 days. I soon received the famous, I would prefer infamous, greetings letter from Uncle Sam telling me to report to my local draft board. I would need to answer some questions from the men who had ultimately passed judgment on my availability for national service. At the time, I was living with my widowed grandmother. I briefly flirted with the idea of seeking a deferment based on the claim that I was her sole means of support, but I knew this was bogus, and even if the government bought it, I wouldn't have been able to live with it. Besides, the order to report to the draft board created in me a certain feeling of importance and opened the door to adventure. There was real trouble in the world, and the nation needed men capable of putting America's best defensive foot forward. This wasn't a job for just anybody. America needed the best. You have to be 21 to think that way. You aren't experienced enough yet to know any better, or wise enough to know that you're not immortal. Every nation of every era has always known that war is for the young. Local Selective Service Board 101 was located at 5437 South Halstead Street in Chicago, about a mile and a half from where I lived. When the big day came, I hopped on the streetcar filled with a sense of adventure. The Army offices were nothing but a vacant storefront furnished with card tables and folding chairs. I was seated at a table across from three old men who looked quite ancient to me as a 21-year-old. They proceeded to ask me questions, verifying what was already on my forms. They checked my name, date of birth, and home address, along with a few things regarding my family and health. After about 10 minutes, they concluded the interview and told me to return to my normal routine. I could expect to hear from them in a few weeks. The draft board wasted no time. I received an order on April 2 to report for a physical exam 2 days later. Passing the exam was the final step for induction. The Army was initially very picky about the mental, moral, family, and physical status of their potential recruits, but their lofty standards dropped dramatically as the war progressed and the need for manpower grew more and more intense. I knew I was in great shape and could count on passing the physical. As I said, none of this really bothered me all that much. My life at the time was far from perfect. I lived in a cold water flat in Chicago's South Side at 4315 South Wells with my grandmother in a poor working-class neighborhood known as Canaryville. It was very near the Chicago stockyards, and local legend holds that the neighborhood got its name because many households put canaries out on their front porches so their singing would drown out the screams of the animals being slaughtered. We did not actually hear the animals dying, but when the wind was right, or wrong, we sure could smell them. My father, who died before my birth, was an ethnic German who immigrated to the United States when he was 21 years old, just before the outbreak of World War I. He left his home and family in the Austrian-Hungarian Empire to avoid the draft and set out to find a better life in America. A skilled tradesman, he settled in the German community on Chicago's South Side and went to work as a cooper, barrel maker, at a local brewery. My uncle became acquainted with him through social events at St. George Parish and brought him home to meet his mother, my grandmother, who took an instant liking to him. She saw him as a hard-working man with a skilled trade, good looks, German blood, and the Catholic faith. This was everything a woman in this neighborhood could hope for in a man, and so my grandmother decided that her 16-year-old daughter would marry him. My folks were married in July of 1917 and moved into a flat in my grandparents' building. My mother always told me that my father loved life, had a great sense of humor, and treated her very well. She also told me that she quickly grew to love him. Their circumstances were, however, very hard. My mother's dad died just a few weeks after her marriage, and then in June 1918, she gave birth to a stillborn son during her 6th month of pregnancy. I was conceived some 3 or 4 months later, but my father died in December 1918 of the flu pandemic at the youthful age of 26. He and my mother had been married for only 18 months, and now she was a widow and 4 months pregnant with me. My mother and grandmother reasoned that life was hard and that responsible adults accepted its circumstances. They instilled the same belief in me. They were repulsed by those few who suggested that an abortion was the answer. I was born the following May. My mother needed a husband to support her and her infant son, which played no small role in her decision to marry my stepfather in January 1920. My stepfather had been a loose acquaintance of my father's and had even been a member of my parents' wedding party. Despite this, he and I never saw eye to eye in anything. My stepfather had us in a typical city bungalow at 4403 South Princeton. He always took in boarders to help make ends meet, so I slept in the family room on a day bed that was too short for me. Our differences continued to mount over the years, and at 19 I moved in with my grandmother on the next block. In my grandmother's eyes I could do no wrong, and my stepfather could do little right. He was tight with a buck and did little more than tolerate me, and my grandmother paid the $1 a month tuition for me to attend St. George's Catholic grade school. My grandmother was old country, typical of her time and background, and believed it was best for people to marry within their own ethnic group and religion. If forced to choose between the two, then choose religion. But in her mind, it was best not to have to choose at all. It was rather understandable that my stepfather resented his mother-in-law. When I was only 6 years old, my grandmother told me about my biological father's death, instilling in me a feeling of loss. The sense of deprivation I felt over the loss of my natural father's love and affection resonated ever more strongly with me as I grew up. It was obvious to me that my stepfather was in many ways my, and my late father's, complete opposite. My stepfather considered me and my friends to be nothing more than a bunch of ne'er-do-wells. My friends always thought him bizarre with his rude mannerisms and frequent cursing, and avoided him whenever possible. With his dour attitude, he was always quick to assure me of two dreadful fates that were certain to befall me. First, that I was destined to grow up to be a bum. In this, I can say, thankfully, that he was very wrong. Second, that I would one day eat wild pears. Here he was more correct than he ever could have imagined. The only thing that was really right in my life at the time was Mary. We had met on a blind date in July 1940. She was intelligent and gorgeous, and she knew it. Far from lacking in self-confidence, she was even a little on the stuck-up side. But she had a good heart and was really a kind person. Mary was about 5 feet 8 inches tall and had brown hair worn in a pageboy, with beautifully matching brown eyes. Her legs were long and slender, and her figure was near perfect. She dressed well, but her true sexiness was contained in a cool air of self-confidence and sophistication that made her a real lady. I was no slouch myself in those days. I was tall with a very full head of brown hair, clear brown eyes, nicely chiseled facial features, and a solid athletic build. My grandmother refused to charge me rent, so I blew most of my money on good clothes. The guys I hung around with respectfully referred to me as the Esquire Kid. The fact that I frequently dated a number of pretty girls earned me the nickname Loverboy Bilder among the local ladies. Mary and I were well suited to each other, and although we didn't have an engagement ring or a wedding date, I proposed to her and she accepted. What possible difference could a year in the army make? By the end of March 1941, the draft had succeeded in putting some 306,000 American men in uniform, about a third of its stated goal. I knew that within days, I would increase that number by one. I reported, as per my orders, on April 4, to the armory on Madison Avenue in Chicago. My letter stated that I was to keep my draft notice with me at all times during the physical. I did so, even during the part of the exam when I was naked. When I arrived at the armory, it was a near mob scene. The army was quick, though, to make order out of the mess. A serviceman asked me my name, noted it, and instructed me to a room where we were told to undress and carry our clothes around with us. It was a Friday, and people must have been anxious to start their weekend because the exams were quick, even by army standards. About 8 of us stood naked in front of 4 doctors seated on folding chairs. The doctors needed to check us for piles, hemorrhoids. They told us to turn around, bend over, and spread our cheeks. There were some poor slobs who didn't know any better and spread the cheeks on their face. I was in good health and quite active with heavy involvement in various athletic pursuits. Anyone could tell just by looking at me that I was in good shape. I did well until the final medical check, which was blood pressure. "That's a little high," the doctor said, with a hint of surprise in his voice. "I don't know whether or not to pass you." We both hesitated for a second. I was torn. I had a feeling of adventure and importance intrinsic to the thought of being drafted at a time of high international tension, but I also had a half-hearted feeling of common sense. I wanted to be free from all this induction business and what it might entail for my life. Yet despite my reservations, down deep, I wanted to pass and be drafted. The doctor must have sensed this as he looked me over. He reflected for an instant, then said, "I'll take a chance on you," and stamped my form as approved. Once our physicals were completed, we assembled in the main hall, which looked a good deal like a gymnasium, where I encountered a former classmate from Tilden High School. He came over from a separate group of men who had failed their physicals. My buddy had been rated 4F for a mastoid ear operation. "Hey, Mike, why don't we switch places?" he asked. "I'll go into the army in your spot." I thought about it for a second, but quickly realized there was absolutely no hope of pulling it off. "I can't," I said. "Besides, we'd never get away with it," I told him. I watched as he walked back to his group looking dejected. I couldn't help but feel sorry for him. For me, as for most young men at the time, feelings of patriotism made military service a rite of passage, of which we were all keenly aware. A sergeant came in and told us to listen up. He said that since we had passed our physicals, we could now consider ourselves in the Army. We had less than 1 week to tie up any loose ends in our civilian lives and to report back to the Armory by 7:30 hours the following Thursday, April 10. Any man who failed to report would be considered a deserter. Mary and my mother cried at the news. My stepfather didn't seem to know how to react. Sears wished me luck and told me that my job would be waiting for me when I came back. I said goodbye to my buddies and prepared myself for a year in the Army. We were instructed to bring nothing but a few toilet articles when we reported for induction. There were to be no suitcases or large bags. At the Armory, all the men with any previous training from military schools or the ROTC were told to step forward and given armbands and sticks with colored circles on the end to help direct us. They absolutely loved it. IQ proficiency exams took the better part of the morning. After we finished, we went into the auditorium and sat in folding chairs until our name was called. When my turn came, I was directed to sit at a table with a soldier who had a typewriter. He noticed on my forms that I had dual training in both a Piper Cub and a Stinson, and also saw that my problem with depth perception had kept me from being a pilot. He asked if I wanted to be an airplane mechanic and work at Chanute Airfield in southern Illinois. I declined, saying that I didn't want to be a grease monkey. I guess I figured such work was beneath me. He noted my answer with a look of surprise. Since I was over 6 feet tall, 195 pounds, and in good shape, he then asked me if I was interested in being an MP. I don't like the idea of being a chicken shit, telling men to button their collars and straighten their shoulders, I replied. This sealed my fate, and I was immediately assigned to the infantry. I soon learned that it wasn't wise to let those in authority know you were carrying a chip on your shoulder. After about 50 of us were gathered, a sergeant came in and told us to get ready to be sworn in. We raised our right hands and took the oath. We were now in the Army. I had just become one of the 923,842 lucky schmucks drafted in 1941. We were directed into yet another room, where we joined about 150 other men and a sergeant. It was about noon. We formed up in columns of two and marched across the street to a beanery called Thompson's, where we helped ourselves to whatever we wanted in the cafeteria line. After about 45 minutes, they formed us up again in columns and marched us over to the train station. Out on Madison Avenue, girls passing by made comments like, "Hiya, soldier," and "Good luck, soldier." We were still in civilian clothes, but there was obviously no mistaking our new employer. Like everyone else, I was very preoccupied with where we were headed and what was next in store. We boarded a train north out of Chicago and into neighboring Lake County, arriving in about an hour at our destination, Fort Sheridan. We still had to march some 3 to 4 miles to the barracks area. This was most definitely a fort. Everything was made of brick and stone. There was nothing resembling the temporary nature of a camp. It reminded me a great deal of a college campus. In a building some four stories high, they broke us down from our original number of about 200 into groups of 20 or 25 men, assigned each group a dorm, and told us to pick out any bunk we wanted. Around 1700 hours, we were ordered to fall out for chow. We stood at attention as best as untrained recruits can on their first day, while sergeants walked up and down our ranks, telling us to suck in our guts, stick out our chests, and pull our shoulders back. After chow, we thought we were through for the day and could relax. We were wrong. They called all 200 of us out and ordered us to form up in a square. A few officers stood in the middle, and a major read us the Articles of War. This was 8 months before Pearl Harbor, but they did remind us that we were conscripts, not volunteers, who had been drafted to allow the country to be ready for war, should that eventuality occur. The major added that our commanders would read us the Articles of War from time to time at their discretion as a reminder of our responsibilities. Sergeants then moved among us again, informing us who would need to get a haircut the following day. Tom Spain, a buddy from my old neighborhood, and I were among the men singled out. Tom and I were individualists. He came from St. Cecilia's, an Irish parish just west of where I lived. It was more upscale than my neighborhood, and definitely on the right side of the tracks. I had chosen Tilden, public high, because of my aversion to discipline. I met Tom and his Irish buddies at Fuller Park while playing ball. They were a lot more boisterous and fun-loving than the Germans in my own parish of St. George, although I floated with ease from one group to the other. I was one of the few crowdheads in with the Irish, and some of the older folk in St. George didn't like it. This was all right with me. I never worried about who approved or did not approve of my actions or my friends. Tom and I had a good deal in common. We were both athletic, popular with the girls, well thought of by the guys, and accustomed to making the world see things our own way. While the army could force us to conform to its methods, it could never make us like it. We both detested army life. After the sergeants finished with us, we were dismissed and headed for our bunks. It was Thursday, April 10, 1941. I'd gotten up from my own bed in Chicago as a civilian, and I was going to sleep in a bunk at Fort Sheridan as a conscript in the army. I was no longer an individual, but the property of Uncle Sam. I was now GI, government issued. The next day, Tom and I felt we didn't need haircuts, so we ignored our first army order. We were denied weekend passes and spent that Saturday shoveling horse manure. We took advantage of an opportunity to have our hair cut on Sunday. The chip on my shoulder had already grown larger. I had been in the army for just 4 days, and I already hated it. Chapter 2. Basic Training and Southern Maneuvers. Learning How to Soldier. I didn't raise my boy to be a soldier. Title of an anti-war song from World War I. On Monday, they marched us back to the railroad tracks, and we boarded a regular troop transport bound for Fort Custer in Battle Creek, Michigan, the home of the 5th Infantry Division and the site of our basic training. From the train, I was able to see St. George's Church and my old neighborhood. The symbolic nature of all this was not lost on me. I had a hunch that things would never be quite the same. I tried to see Dorchester, where Mary lived, but we didn't pass close enough for me to do so. We gave our name as we stepped off the train and were told our unit assignments. I was assigned to Company F, Fox, in the 10th Regiment. They formed us up into our respective companies in columns of two and took us to areas where platoon sergeants were waiting. We were assigned to a platoon, taken to barracks, and assigned a bed. We were now all numbered and pegged. The barracks were wooden frame and two stories high. I was on the first floor between two windows. We were marched over to the supply depot, where we were issued clothes and two pairs of shoes. Some of our equipment was left over from World War I, including the saucepan helmets that the American doughboys had used. We spent the following few days learning how to salute, stand at attention, march in formation, and the like. After about a week, we were issued a rifle, ammunition belt, and a pack. I qualified as an expert on almost every weapon, rifle, machine gun, and hand grenade. The sole exception was the .45-caliber sidearm, which has a powerful recoil. I thought it kicked like a mule, and I had great difficulty hitting anything at all with it. Somehow I did manage to qualify on it, though just barely. Reveille was at 600 hours sharp. We had 5 minutes to get our dress uniform on and fall out into our platoon for roll call. We stood in 4 neat rows and counted off, man by man. The platoon sergeant had to hear 4 counts of 11, or else it meant that someone was missing. After we were dismissed, we scrambled in a mad dash for toilets and wash basins. We then had to sweep up and mop under our beds and make the beds with military corners tucked so tightly that a quarter dropped flatly onto the bed surface would literally bounce. Next came mess hall, where we proceeded in line along serving areas where they dumped something resembling food into our mess kits. The tables looked like those at a public picnic area. There were often extra servings of food at our tables, like milk, bread, and potatoes. The standing rule was that anyone who took the last serving of any such item was duty-bound to get up and replenish the supply. Outside were 50-gallon drums filled with soapy water for us to clean our mess kits, cups, and utensils. Back at the barracks, we received orders on how to dress for the day. It was usually fatigues and leggings. We carefully hung up our dress uniforms, put on our assigned clothes, and headed down to the parade grounds for 30 minutes of calisthenics, after which they broke us down into squads to perform close-order drill. To help us keep time when we drilled, they had us sing songs. Sometimes we intentionally messed up our marching songs, both for fun and to irritate our sergeants. If the sergeant was at the back of our line, the men at the front would start singing something like "Gooey Gooey Gumdrops" or some other such nonsense. When the sergeant ran up to the front to see who the culprits were, the men went silent and others in the rear picked it up. Finally, in frustration, the sergeants would just order everyone to be quiet and we marched without any singing. Our forced marches started out slow, with distances of about 5 miles, then graduated to 10 miles, 15, and finally 20 miles per day. We were soon fit and trim and able to cover these distances without much difficulty. The outfit I was assigned to, the 10th Infantry Regiment, was regular Army. This meant that it existed in peacetime and was not a new unit, created primarily for conscripts. Most of the men in this outfit had enlisted, so I was among the few draftees in its ranks. The 10th Regiment had been activated at Fort Hays in Ohio in 1933, but in my experience, with the exception of a few Midwesterners who were draftees, most of the ranks were Southerners, who had come from its previous location at Fort Thomas in Kentucky. This was certainly the case in my barracks, and the Southerners obviously had no real use for those of us from the North. Southern ways and Southern men were new to me. I listened to the Yellow Rose of Texas and songs with lyrics like, "I've got tears in my ears from lying on my back crying over you," until I was ready to be sick. I enjoyed Glenn Miller, the big band sound, jitterbug, and swing. Country music was as far from my tastes as I could imagine, and seemed as backward to me as the hillbilly lifestyle in general. I had the feeling that many of the Southerners got their first pair of shoes when they joined the Army, maybe also their first toothbrush. Theirs was a new and different culture, and being in the Army didn't make my introduction to it any easier. I knew we had to put up with some Southern hazing, but one guy in particular, a 19-year-old kid from one of the Carolinas, was always pushing the limit. He was a huge guy, so he figured he could get away with it. "You gotta watch these Yankees," he'd say. "They'll cheat you at cards, steal your gal, and lie all the time." I put up with this haranguing for about a week before I finally blew up. "Why don't you shut up, you hillbilly," I said. "We licked you in the Civil War and we could lick you again." He didn't jump. He flew over 3 bunks and had me on the floor in the tightest bear hug humanly possible. My arms were completely pinned, and he was literally squeezing the life out of me. The other Southerners were chanting, "Stomp him! Stomp him!" I managed to look over at the few Northerners in the barracks, but they just returned a look that said, "What the hell are we supposed to do?" The platoon sergeant came in and broke it up, but it didn't end there. "You guys want to fight?" the sergeant asked. "Okay, we'll settle this tonight behind the coal pile after chow." I was shaken up by the Northerners in my barracks reminded me that while my opponent was big and could wrestle, he probably didn't know the first thing about boxing. This was a break for me, because I excelled at amateur boxing. I was a very capable all-around amateur athlete. I was in good shape, was a very strong swimmer, and played football and baseball well. I not only had experience in the amateur ring, but in a poor Chicago neighborhood like Canaryville, our main idea of contact sports was bare-knuckle fights and vacant lots. I knew the trick would be to stay mobile. I had to jab him in the nose to stun him and still stay loose so he couldn't get hold of me with those huge, powerful arms. Once the fight started, he came at me with his arms curved and outstretched. I hit him in the nose with two quick left jabs and jumped away. He still didn't raise his arms to protect himself. He was stunned, but he just kept coming at me as he had before. I jabbed and backed away, jabbed and backed away. If he got close, I hopped out of his reach or pushed him aside. The jabs had the desired effect, and his reactions became slower and slower. I was only using my left hand. I'm right-handed. But even that drew a fair amount of blood from the kid's nose and lips. He had bruises and knuckle marks on his face, but still he kept coming. It was painfully obvious that this was now a very one-sided fight. The sergeant, who had wanted the other guy to win, finally stepped in and called a halt. After the fight, there were no more comments from anyone about Yankees or their evil ways. Oddly enough, this southern kid and I ended up becoming very good friends. He was still with the 10th Regiment when it shipped out for Iceland. We both remained in the 5th Division when we got to France, but we were in different regiments. I was truly very sorry when I got the news he had been killed in action. Despite this incident, I wasn't on the wrong side of many sergeants. One by the name of Kroger had taken a strong liking to me from the beginning. He had immigrated to the United States from Germany some 18 years before, and had spent the last 17 of them in the Army. We spoke to each other in German, and he even recommended me for promotion to corporal after only 6 weeks. Nothing came of it, since conscripts were not promoted to corporal after only 6 weeks in the Army. A soldier named Al Carslake, one of the guys who supported me the evening I had to refight the Civil War, came up to me one night pretty much out of the blue and asked me if I wanted to go see the movie they were running that evening. I really wasn't in the mood to go, but I felt kind of obligated to him. Besides, a movie with fresh hot popcorn was one of the few childhood pleasures I carried into adulthood, and the base theater always served up fresh popcorn. "I guess my letters can wait," I told him. "My family's coming up Sunday anyway, so why not?" After the movie, another soldier named Steiner joined us. He and Carslake were both from Sault Ste. Marie and had been friends before the service. I guess they must have been homesick for the farmlands back in Michigan because Al suggested we walk over to the parade grounds. As we were walking, he started to sing and Steiner joined in. They sang a few tunes before they looked at me to take a verse, but they were singing farm songs that I had never heard before. "I'm sorry, fellas," I said, "but I don't know these songs." Fortunately, we all knew classics like Down by the Old Mill Stream and contemporary stuff like I'll Be With You in Apple Blossom Time. The three of us harmonized quite well, and we got into the habit of meeting at night whenever we could by a particular tree near the parade grounds where we would sing songs and talk of home. The three of us became good friends. I also became good friends with a couple of other guys. A soldier from Michigan named Vern Kellner and I struck up a conversation in the chow line one day. We decided to go to the movies that night, and as we talked, we discovered we had many similar tastes. Later, a third soldier named Roger Whitney ended up rounding out our trio. There was another southern kid that all of us, befriended right from the start. His name was McCoy, and this poor kid had no business being in the Army. He must have been inducted because some southern draft board had a quota to fill. McCoy was only a little over 5 feet tall, and he had great difficulty keeping up with us. Everyone in the outfit did what they could to help him out, but he just couldn't make the grade. He was unable to qualify with the weapon. He couldn't perform close order drill. He couldn't dig a proper foxhole. He simply couldn't cut it as a soldier. Once, when we were marching and McCoy was out of step, which was customary for him, some SOB of a buck sergeant stuck a walking stick or a broom handle between his legs and sent him tumbling. This idiot had the idea that this would force McCoy to stay in step. After we were dismissed, I walked up to the sergeant and told him privately, "You ever use that stick on that kid again, and I'll make you eat it when I catch you in Battle Creek." He didn't respond, but he never used that stick again either. We took photographs of McCoy standing next to us, and it looked like we were posing with a grade school kid in uniform. We submitted the photos and our comments to the company commander. Sergeant Kroger took up the cause, and the army finally came through with a discharge from McCoy. It may have been a small victory, but it made all of us feel good. We had cheated the stupidity inherent in the huge army bureaucracy and given the poor kid an opportunity we couldn't have, a guaranteed chance to grow old and die of natural causes. There were also other guys who didn't belong in the army, or at least in the infantry, although none of them was as obvious a case as McCoy. By the time we got into combat, the army, to its credit, had done a reasonable job of ensuring that everyone there could cut it. I miss Mary desperately. On occasion, the army didn't issue me a weekend pass, but that didn't stop me from going home to see her. This was still the peacetime army, and the restrictions on us were nothing like they would be once war was declared. A main road ran right through the middle of Fort Custer, and I could get on a bus or hitch a ride right past the front gate. There was no checking for passes on the weekend. They wouldn't even know I was gone until Sunday morning roll call. I never let Mary know if I was AWOL, since she clearly would not have approved. During one of these unauthorized leaves, however, Mary and I ran into someone from Fort Custer in my old neighborhood. "They know," he said to me right in front of Mary. "They'll be waiting for you on Monday morning." I had to let Mary in on my secret and assure her it was no big deal. In peacetime, the punishment for a weekend AWOL was minimal. At first, I was simply given KP duty. I'd previously worked as a short-order cook, so after I finished my KP work, I'd whip myself up a nice little meal. This the Army did not appreciate, so my punishment for unauthorized weekend leaves became to guard the meanest prisoners in the stockade. Most guys had committed some relatively minor infraction and had sentences of only 2 or 3 weeks. I was assigned to guard prisoners who had committed real crimes, like striking an officer, and received sentences of 6 months or longer. This was too long to be served in the fort stockade, so these men were dishonorably discharged and sent to Leavenworth Military Prison. Leavenworth was not to be taken lightly. Every soldier knew its reputation and regarded it as a fate worse than death. In fact, the thought of Leavenworth later provided me with added incentive to go back and face combat time and again. On guard duty, I was given a double-barreled shotgun and told not to let any of these guys get within 25 feet of me. The word was that any guard who let a buddy or fellow soldier with a hard luck story escape had to finish out the prisoner's sentence. I don't know if it was true or not, but I wasn't about to take any chances. I remember one time when a southern prisoner decided to get a little defiant. I pulled back both hammers so he could hear them cock. He was quick to obey any directives I gave him after that. Coming off this detail, I was hopping mad about having had to perform it in the first place. I slammed my shotgun back into the gun rack without checking to be sure that the hammers were no longer cocked. The gun discharged and the buckshot from both barrels went through the ceiling. I was almost court-martialed, but the matter was dropped before the paperwork could be completed. This type of incredible good luck followed me throughout my entire time in the Army. A junior officer once said to me in Europe, "Bilder, you have more shit and luck in one finger than most men have in their entire body." It was true, and looking back, I can say that it was a miracle I made it through alive and free of court-martial. When Mary came up to visit, she took the train from Chicago and stayed in a room arranged by the Red Cross Club. On occasion, she came up with Tom Spain's girl, Irma. She and Tom had grown up next door to each other and probably had crushes on one another since childhood. Mary hated to make the trip up to Battle Creek alone, and I imagine that Irma felt the same way. The four of us got along well together. Mary and I spent Saturdays walking in the park or window shopping in Battle Creek. In the evening, we went out dancing at local places like the Post Tavern. I returned to the barracks at night and stood for reveille and roll call the next morning. After Sunday Mass, we'd repeat the same routine all over again. Mary was quite an operator. If I couldn't swing a weekend pass, she would pick up the phone and call the base. Claiming to be my mother, she would ask to speak to my commanding officer. She would explain that she had come up all the way from Chicago to visit her boy and would be terribly disappointed if she had to return home without seeing him. Besides, at her age, she couldn't be sure how many visits she had left. Couldn't her son please be granted a weekend pass? My CO was either very kind or very easily fooled, because this farce worked every time she pulled it. This was especially funny because my mother was only 40 years old at the time and had another 40 years to live. Joe Lewis came to Fort Custer on a goodwill tour. I saw Lewis and his sparring partner and many other members of his crew mix it up in the ring. They put on quite a show, and everyone was truly impressed. Afterward, I went over to their truck to tell them how impressed I was by their bouts and to pick up a few pointers. I asked how they were able to keep up such an incredible pace in the ring while sustaining such hard blows. As it turned out, they were more actors than boxers. They handed me a pair of their boxing gloves so I could see for myself that they were made of pure foam rubber. You could get hit by a blow and barely feel it, much less get hurt. I left them much wiser, but a little disillusioned. Another valuable lesson I learned quickly in the army was not to volunteer for anything. Once, when we were in formation, they asked anyone who could type to raise his hand. A few hands shot up from eager beavers who anticipated cushy office jobs. They were immediately informed that they had just volunteered for garbage detail. Even in peacetime, the army was not to be taken too lightly, so I tried to do my duty with as little pushback as possible. I was not out to be a hero, a career military man, or a leader of men. But at the same time, I would not shirk my duties and responsibilities. I was independently minded, but even when I didn't like it, which was most of the time, I did what was expected of me. In the military, as in civilian life, I got along well with just about everyone. On one occasion, we were rounded up out of a sound sleep, blindfolded, and driven outside the fort to a wooded area. We were given a compass, the coordinates back to the fort, and an order to return as quickly as possible. It was a crystal clear night.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.